So, sir, I know, you know, I have invited you and this episode is about you. But I have a very important question to ask, you know, something very pressing. Can I have a job?
You can have a job, but you didn't ask where.
Hey, guys, what's up? So today's episode is with Senior Advocate Gopal Sankaranarayanan, sir. And, you know, it's an amazing episode. It's a profound episode. I was saving it for the last as the finale, but in the last 2-3 months, you know, academic submissions, a lot of unexpected rejections. So I thought, why not do something unexpected myself? So I am releasing this episode. We discuss his life at NLS, how he became a senior counsel, his whole journey, the technicalities involved. He has shared so many anecdotes. And, you know, the best part you will see after the episode is his attitude. I mean, obviously, he's a great lawyer, but he's also a great person because he made me feel so comfortable. I mean, not a lot of people have that necessarily. They have the ability, but they don't make that kind of effort. So he makes that. And one caveat, please do not think that there's any controversy or we have taken any names, because this episode was recorded before the Prashant Bhushan case and whatever has been happening since the last 2-3 months. This was recorded in June, and I'm quite glad that that was the thing, because then we really focused on his personality, what he is as a person, and that's the focus of my podcast, not the news. I'm not a journalist. So certainly you guys will enjoy it. And I'm sorry, I have not been very frequent with the uploads, simply because, I mean, things really haven't gone my way quite in past few weeks. So I hope, you know, better time will come. And yeah, man, we'll win. Or not. I mean, it's fine to lose sometimes. So. Also, please subscribe. Otherwise, I'll just keep doing this. I'm cute, no? Also, we have discussed Indian judiciary and environment law. So don't worry. We have covered quite a few contemporary topics.
The most disturbing thing that happens, which really has nothing to do with law, is the fact that my number, for some reason, maybe about 20 years ago, used to belong to the Simtex Coil Company. It's a company that makes coils for air conditioners. So every 3 days, I get a call from somebody who says, sir, aapke paas coil pada hai. To be honest, 50% of the time, I say, ye wrong number hai. But it's the other 50% that's fun. So I ask him what type of coil he wants. So I've learned a lot about coils. AC coil. So if Simtex Coil Company is ever watching this, please learn that you tell your customers to correct yourself. Many times I've said, "Chotu yahan pe nahi hai, aapko pick up karna padega." I've given them addresses in Ghazipur and stuff.
Hey guys, maybe I should start a podcast.
No.
What's up? Welcome to another episode of Fun With Law. And honestly, when I started, I never thought that I'll be here, genuinely. And today I have my guest, Senior Advocate Gopal Sankaranarayanan. And I'm just so happy to have him. And he's the only senior counsel that I've invited on my podcast, because I knew he's the one with a different perspective. And he's young and he's, you know, he's hip, he's cool. So he'll give answers that we'll be able to, you know, connect with. And thanks a lot for having me. Sorry, come. I'm just so nervous to appear on the episode.
it's a pleasure. I love chatting with people who are a lot like me when I was in college, and I understand all the tribulations and the nervousness and the doubts that one has. So I try my best whenever I can have conversations with them, which is not often, to chat with them and just like shoot the breeze. So. Yeah. I have seen snippets of your previous episodes, and it sounds interesting and fun, and it's a great initiative, Jalaj. So congratulations, and let's get moving. Tell me.
Thank you. So, sir, I know, you know, I have invited you and this episode is about you, but I have a very important question to ask, you know, something very pressing. Can I have a job?
You can have a job, but you didn't ask where.
So. Okay, that's a good answer. But yeah, but to the viewers, I would like to say that Gopal sir is also my competitor because he has his own show on the My Law channel, and you know, I think this is collaborating. We're giving each other, you know, visibility.
Yeah.
On social.
Correct. But, so I've suspended that show actually.
Okay.
We did 4 episodes and we've taken time off because both Nikhil of My Law was also was in college with me and me. We're both working to try and get those shramiks home and get them food and stuff. So okay. He's actually been going to the railway stations every single day.
Yeah.
And we thought there isn't enough bandwidth because it requires a lot of preparation, as you probably know.
Yes.
So it's taking a lot of our time. So we've taken a break from that. We'll be back in another 2 weeks. So you don't have any competition for a while.
Yeah, but you know, you have really, you have like tennis players, and that's what I love about you. You know, you're a lawyer, but you not just only speak about law. You are in your university, you are into sports, and you're still into, you know, music, and you have beautiful paintings and everything. So obviously we'll talk about that. So let's begin. Can you tell me 2-3, you know, turning points in your journey? Because obviously there's a lot of literature available about you, you know. There's super law interview, so something that is unique, you know, those 2-3 turning points has actually changed you, changed your perspective.
Well, for me, most of the points in my life are definitive of who I am. So it's not necessarily with reference to the profession as such. So I think one major turning point for me was coming to Delhi for my 11th and 12th. My father happened to be posted here. And I had been in a boys' school throughout in Bangalore. So I was suddenly thrown into the complete deep end. So I came to Delhi in my 11th standard. So I moved from complete boys' school ICSE system to a co-educational DPS Arkepuram, which is like a factory. There are 1,300 students in 12th standard alone. And I was in the humanities section, and I was the only student in that entire humanities section who had come from outside. Everybody else had come up from 10th standard. And there were 9 guys in the class, 64 girls. I'm 15 and a half. And I'm back in those days, you can imagine, guys were not polite. I'm sure they're still not polite. They were very dear friends. But they would say, "Ye kala kaun hai?" immediately that I came in. And for me, I mean, it wasn't even, it didn't even strike me that this is a pejorative, right? I mean, today, I think, we are so aware of these things. So when we have a West Indian cricket player ask questions of his Sunrisers Hyderabad teammates, it makes us all think that, you know, when they did that then, they weren't really being polite. They later became friends and they continued the same epithet. But it doesn't change where it started. So for me, I think it was it was also the first time, it's shocking, I've shared this with someone else earlier, that I had 2 guys sitting on either side of me, and both of them were sons of IAS officers. And one guy told me at some point that guy, and he used an epithet again, and said he's going to make it to the IAS because his father comes from a reserved category. Possibly my ignorance and the irony of it now that I'm doing reservation cases, but I asked him, what does that mean? Because we had never in school in Bangalore ever been open to this idea of caste and stuff. It never even entered our minds. I mean, it was obviously extremely protected. So for me, this is true, by the way. The guy didn't get into IAS. He got into IFS. But I just think that people were so aware about all these things, about color and about caste. And it's just not a few people, many of them. And it was a trial by fire because you really got thrown in the deep end and you had to try and swim and survive. So for me, that was one major turning point. The second major turning point, I think, was joining Mr. Venugopal's office, because a lot of what I am in the profession is him. A lot of what I am is not him also. but it's about understanding how a man lives in this profession and the ethics that he lives by, and then trying to take the best of that, right? But like every human being, there are flaws, and so you have to figure out if that works for you or it doesn't. So that was a second. It's been a great training ground, a great place. I mean, it's like home for many of us who come from his chamber. So we call him at any point and just, you know, boss, here's a problem, that kind of stuff. It's great. And it's a kind of mentorship I feel that we should all continue as much as we can. And the third is actually getting married to an absolutely fantastic woman and becoming a parent. I put that together, though it happened apart from each other. But it really makes you, it strengthens you in many ways, but it also makes you very, very vulnerable. So I think it brings out sides of you which you didn't see you had, because you've always been this, you know, ragtag kind of, I'm on my own kind of thing. You know, you feel like a pirate, and then suddenly the pirate is nailed down and you're trying to figure out, dude, there's so much more to trying to figure out how life works. And so many different perspectives of it, which are drawn up by being a parent and being a spouse and being a supportive husband in this day and age when your spouse has a career and has to follow it. So I think those are three major turning points for me. I think they were critical.
Yeah. Also, if you think about it, now you're not just responsible for your own life, but also for your children's life.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And the things you do right now might not impact you as a person, but whatever things are happening with your children, they're going to impact them forever. And that is true.
No, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. That's true.
And what has been your biggest failure?
It's tough to say, because, you know, there are so many little obstacles and hurdles that you come by, and you wish it could have gone better or gone differently. I wish I could have made more time to actually write, because it's something that I've always liked to do. I had taken a break from the profession in 2004 to 2006. Ooh. 2 years, I just took off. I didn't work.
And where did what was that like?
I went back home to Bangalore, where my folks were. I had worked with Mr. Venugopal for a few years. And then I was not sure whether I wanted to continue doing this, continue doing law or litigation. So what little I had saved, I was fortunate. He's a very generous paymaster. So I did have savings. Very few people in litigation have savings. So I blew that up over that year and a half. I traveled quite a bit, pretty much backpacking. It's like a find yourself kind of thing. I wrote short stories. I wrote 10 short stories. I also did a TV show script, 26 episodes with two friends of mine. We co-wrote that. We pitched it at a time when there was no digital TV, so we still have it here. It's called The Family. It's about the life of a father and three kids. One of the kids comes back from the US and how life evolves around them in Bombay. There's a Parsi boyfriend, there's a mechanic next door, there's lots of fun stuff thrown into that. We had spent about 6-7 months of our lives then. Brinali, Nikhil, me, Arvind, we all spent a lot of time working on that. I think that's the biggest failure, because I wasn't able to peddle either at that point of time. We went really with the show to only a couple of people. And one of them, I can mention, Bag Films in Noida, asked us, what will the Nagpur housewives think about this? I said, who? So she said, you don't know, young man, the Nagpur housewives, they are the ones who decide on the Saas Bahu serials. If they don't like this, it won't run. I said, thank you very much. Goodbye. So, yeah. But today, I think there's a lot of potential if you wanted to try and peddle it. We'll obviously have to change the language and stuff. But yeah, that's my failure. And, you know, doing fiction writing and semi-fictional work. Yeah. It's something that's always part of me. I adore films. I'm a student of cinema. Yeah. So I always have been so enthralled by that, the world of telling stories.
Yeah.
So I think that, well, that's a major failure. It has nothing to do with law.
You know, I think that's a, I don't know, that's a very insightful answer, because I've never told this to anyone, like not any, like not even a single soul, but I have written, like, it's half complete. I have a 20-30 page movie script written that I've been, I've been writing since 11th grade. So it's like, I want to make it, you know, semi-autobiographical, where the first and the second act will be from my life, but the third act will be, you know, that there are three acts in the script writing.
Third
act will be something, I don't know, something completely different from who I want to be. It's like a different road that I want to go on. I don't know. Yeah, I'm just,
But have you worked out the plot and revised it many times or something? I mean, if you've spent that much time working on it?
Yeah, so every couple of months, you know, I pull it out, and whatever has happened, major, you know, has happened in my life, I try and integrate that. So it's really, because sometimes I believe all of us are in a movie, you know, all of us, if we pick out the right plot points, every we all are a story. And that's how you as a person.
That's so true.
Like whenever I go for interviews, whenever I speak to someone, I sell myself as a story rather than saying, you know, I have achieved this, achieved that. It's I mean, okay, so we are deviating here.
No, that's okay.
So now, so how comfortable are you with fame? Because, you know, being a senior counsel, when we look at you and something that you have, you know, really achieved at quite an early age, and you've done quite a few things with which I don't know if you did it for fame, but can lead to it. For example, you know, there are episodes of My Law where you are a part of it. There are, for example, you're now you have a probably a TV script, you know, written, and you have quite a few things going on, and there are news articles about you. There recently a controversy happened. How comfortable are you with the concept?
I hate it. I abhor it. I am fortunate that I'm not famous. It's a question that I've asked people who are famous about their loss of anonymity. There are many in our profession who are on, you know, on Twitter and Facebook, who have got Wikipedia pages made for themselves. And I keep wondering why? I mean, look, beyond a point, apart from the fact that you're selling yourself as a professional, talking about your legal work, et cetera, which I don't agree with. I think the fact is you have to be comfortable with the idea at some point that people are going to venerate you. Okay. If you're good at what you do, or even if you're not good at what you do, if you're presented to be good at what you do. And there are some people who crave that. Shah Rukh Khan famously always said that, look, this is what I wanted. I wanted not to be anonymous. I wanted millions of people screaming my name. And there are people who crave that and fight for that and buy for that and go for that. I hate it. I'm an extremely, and many of my friends who know me have always wondered that this can't be true. Many years ago, I took this Myers-Briggs test. That's a test that they administer to those who get into through management school and all when they want to recruit them to check their personality types. So they ask 50 questions. And they check from one extreme of being a complete gregarious extrovert to being a closed up introvert. And I wound up as a complete closed up introvert, which is what I am. I don't like to, you know, project myself, or like in large groups, I hate it because I'm usually a wallflower standing in a corner, sipping on a drink, wanting to just chat with one person. Right. So I'm comfortable chatting like this, you and me chatting. I love it. It's great. I get to learn a bit about you as well. It's great. But this huge melange of people, it's completely superficial. And we're fooling ourselves if we believe that, you know, fame really means anything. And I don't think I'm famous. I just think I happen to be a designated senior advocate. Let's be honest, man. I mean, what's a big deal there? It's for people who are in the profession who think it's a big deal. But I can tell you from the other side, after getting designated, it's not a big deal. You're the same guy. You're the same person. Some people may give you a little longer hearing or give you a little more regard. Your fees may go up a bit. But in the larger scheme of things, this is not fame. I mean, it's just what you do.
All right. Also now, you know, you talk about, because I want to draw a parallel between the person you were at the age of 20 and the person you are at the age of 40s, you know, that thing. Because that really fascinates me. Because you know that in the beginning also you said, you know, you think you're a pirate in the beginning and then suddenly responsibilities. Number one, have you achieved the goals that you set for yourself at the age of 20 or, you know, in your law school life at NLS? And have you achieved them till you now?
I had only one goal, to be honest, only one goal. And that was to be a litigating lawyer in the Supreme Court. Okay. So I pretty much achieved that on day one. I knew, I became aware as time wore on that, you know, there's this class system that we had and that the senior advocates get a little more eyeballs and stuff like that. But I'm happy to say that in the last few years, at least, we've begun to see that judges have become more tolerant of non-seniors, become more accommodating at all. Not all of them, but quite a few of them. The numbers have increased of those who are willing to hear from non-seniors, etc. It also helps, I think, that the competence levels of lawyers have really gone up. I think it's really helped that there are more kids coming into litigation. I'm so happy to see that. I think all that has made a big difference to the profession, which is a good thing. But to answer your question, yeah, I've achieved that goal which I set myself. The goal which I had not set myself, but which I always thought I would be at some point, is being a parent. I really love kids. I love playing with them. Just 3 months ago, I had a matter before Justice Chandrachud as a final hearing and winding up, and I had promised to go to a two of my second and third kids, and they go for a play. They go to play football and sports and stuff like that. They're really small. So because of the bad air outside, there's an indoor facility, which a guy, Richard, he runs. It's very, very nice. And he wanted to do a storytelling session. So he asked any of the dads to come and do a storytelling session. So I put my hand up and said, yes, I'll come and do a story session. And I was running short of time because it was 4:30. And at 4 o'clock, I was arguing before Justice Chandrachud and went on till 4:10. So exactly 20 minutes later, I'm in front of a bunch of 25 little kids on my knees, wearing a black hat and making funny faces and reading out a beautiful story about a pig. And I was thinking to myself in my head that, hey, if I could do this for a living, you know, it'd be so much better than what I just did half an hour ago. And that's actually, there's so much to it. I mean, I love the fact of being a parent and being around little kids and trying to, you know, expand their horizons. And I mean, many of my friends say, so are your kids going to be lawyers? I was like, look, I'm not going to stop them from what they want to be, but I don't want them to think that this is actually a cool cat thing to be, because there's so much else in the world. Yeah. So for me, that's the other object that I had of being a parent, and I'm so happy and proud to be one.
That's the thing, right? Sometimes I think whenever I see people at your stage and, you know, at your age speaking about, you know, when they are successful at, they conventionally successful here, I'm talking about, with regard to their profession, then they start feeling that, you know, I could be good at other things also. And, you know, like,
yeah,
when you are in process, I don't think so. Are these thoughts quite healthy when you are at my age to think, you know, what if I could be a storyteller? What do you...
Not at all unhealthy. In fact, I remember that I used to look back at the batch immediately after me from my college, the 2002 batch at National Law School. They were a strange bunch of guys. I never figured why they decided to do law. Half of them are top class lawyers. The other half are doing the most random crazy stuff in the world, which has nothing to do with law. Right? One of them plays poker for a living. Another guy runs a kitchen and a restaurant. A third guy does he does some strange kind of guiding bird watchers in the Northeast or some stuff like that. A fourth guy is taking guitar lessons in Bangalore. He's a proper guitar teacher. So I keep looking at them and I'm thinking, it's amazing, isn't it, that you can devote your life to 5 years of law and then just go and do exactly what you want. So no, absolutely not. I mean, if you have a life as a career storyteller, you should do it. There are people who balance both. I know Krishna Uday Shankar, who has written a series of fantastic books on mythology and is also holding a job as a top level commercial lawyer.
Yeah. And, you know, now when we talk about these things, you spoke about, like money is something that, you know, I'm really fascinated by. And the thing is, as a society, we don't talk about it much. And, yeah. And I genuinely feel that people have to talk about it, you know, for us.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
What did you do with your first decent paycheck? Not the first one, like, you know, like first substantial one where you had a choice to, you know, spend it on anything you want to.
So, yeah, I think that's a very important aspect that you mentioned, that, you know, money is important. And I think many people underestimate the level of privilege they have. So I think when I was younger, I underestimated the fact that when I was entering the profession, while it was first generation for me, what did help was that, you know, I had folks who had some savings, who could help out with the rent if necessary, who were backups. There are many people in the profession today, when they enter, they don't have that kind of support. So yeah, it's good to acknowledge and remember that and not to exploit it, and try to do it yourself so you can say you stood up on your own 2 feet, right? Like, The young lawyer who comes to court on the first day driving a BMW is never going to understand that climb, because it's best that he left the BMW at home and took a bus so that he understood what the climb and the struggle is about. He gets to appreciate it more. Others appreciate him more. It's good that you have all this, but it's great to just force yourself to try and do it on your own, you know? So yes, with my first big paycheck, I went to Old Delhi, and just at the foot of the steps of the Jama Masjid, there are a bunch of record shops, very, very old LPs. And they try to rip you off, but as long as you can bargain them down and get good quality records, you'd actually examine them from the sleeve and stuff like that. I bought 10 records with the first. It cost me, I think, around 2,000 bucks or so at that time, 200 bucks for each. That's the first thing that I remember doing, which is a bit of a splurge as well.
Yeah. I mean, you always get interesting answer to these questions. You know, I always love to. So also, you know, when I speak to my friends about money, you know, I get very delusional answers. You know, I get answers like, you know, it doesn't matter how much you make. I mean, but it does matter. Like, it does matter.
Of course it does.
Like, I'm not saying it gives you power, but it certainly gives you freedom to, you know,
choose.
So, has your perspective to, see, obviously, we know you're a senior counsel, right? So, the capacity to pull more money towards yourself is obviously higher. So, how has the perspective towards money changed for you from your 20s and now at your 40s?
Yeah, I always thought that, hey, I wish I would have lots of money so that I could buy massive, huge, shocking gifts for friends and family and stuff like that, right? There's a friend who loves a particular brand of a 1976 Ferrari. And I had thought, hey, by the time I'm 40, I'm going to get you the Ferrari. Okay.
Yeah.
It's a leveler when you reach 40 and you're like, dude, what happened? Where's all that money supposed to be, right? I'm 43. And those big bucks come to you much later. Let me make that clear, okay? You're going to spend a large part of your life touch and go. I was designated last year. So at 41, when you're designated, you think, oh, wow, this is the time when it's going to take off. That's not really true, okay? In the last year and a half, your appearances will still keep happening, right? But it's important for you to understand that you're still on that cusp where if you're going to feel suddenly that, hey, you know, you're some big stud and you can like charge lakhs, you can forget about it because they will turn the tap off immediately and then you're left to dry. Then you're finished. Okay, nobody's going to come back to you after that. The idea is that you continue to do good work, keep your feet firmly on the ground, and the touch and go will change at some point. It hasn't changed yet. I mean, it'll be happy for many people who are struggling to know that even a senior advocate will struggle with dough.
Yeah.
I'm just hoping that it will change with time. But it's not really, just because you get designated is no measure of the fact that, hey, it's all going to be bagfuls that are coming through the doors. That's not the truth.
All right. So now, you know, talking about being designated at the age of 41, and you know, so can you walk me through the process? How do you get designated? You know, because I mean, it's slightly confusing, and for our viewers who are non-lawyers, I mean, it would be a good.
Well, it's usually conventionally for many years, they used to, each court has its own practices, but if at some point of time you feel that you have argued enough cases and you have made enough of an impact, there are many reported judgments, you've contributed to the profession in some way, you feel invested in it, and you feel strong enough that people will come and brief you, right, without you filing cases yourselves. Right? Because what happens in our profession across the country is that in most courts, except one or two, you don't have the system of a solicitor and an arguing advocate separately. So they're both packed into one person. So you go to one lawyer, and that person will draft your case, file it, argue it. But in both the Supreme Court, the Bombay High Court, you have the system clearly of solicitors and advocates on record as they are, who do the filing, and then somebody else engaged to be the arguing counsel. So in Bombay, for example, there's a very strong non-solicitor young junior bar, which are given briefs to assist a senior counsel, to brief, etc. So that's a great healthy process for people to learn to argue. In the Supreme Court, we don't have that. We have the advocate on record and we have a senior advocate, really. So that middle rung, you have to try and fend for yourself. So more and more people do the advocates on record exam, or they marry an advocate on record. So, you know, that way there's somebody in the family who's doing the filing and somebody else who can do the arguing. So the big struggle is, both Haripriya, my wife, and I, we were both from Mr. Venugopal's chambers and all, and we both love to argue. And we really don't have a mind for, you know, the accountancy that needs to be done to ensure how money gets divided, how it comes in for the senior counsel and for the briefing part of it and stuff like that, as well as, you know, maintaining long ledgers, interacting with the registry guys, trying to get something listed, trying to get a filing done. It's all a huge, huge headache. So neither of us became advocates on record. We're pretty clear that, hey, we want to argue. So the struggle is getting people to have repose faith in you, to say, hey, why don't you argue? Because nowadays, you find very often, almost everybody is doing the AOR exam and they're saying, hey, I'll argue, why should I get somebody else to do it, right?
Yeah.
So you fall between two stools, really. And that's why it's a bit of a struggle. That's why when people get designated, there's always a question about what route they take. Were they solicitors who got designated, or were they, you know, non-solicitors, arguing counsel who got designated? But to be honest, I can't really, about 3 years ago with the Indra Jai Singh case, the Supreme Court laid down very detailed parameters on how exactly designations will be done. Yeah. So they had a system of allotting points and having interviews and blah, blah, blah. The interview process, really, because nearly 110 people from the Supreme Court applied, became a bit of a farce because there were no one-on-one interviews, 40 people in a room, and the judges say, does anybody ever say anything? So you don't really interact. But the judges have all seen who actually has been appearing for a while. But I can't put a finger on it, because if I look at the 35 of us who are designated, it's the largest designation that they did in their history at one go. There are guys who I thought were competent and who had been around for a long while who were not designated. There were people who had appeared maybe in about two cases in their lives in the Supreme Court arguing final hearings, and they got designated. So a lot of it, I think, has to do with, as it works everywhere else, a bit of somebody pushing somebody's name and saying, hey, let's go make that person, etc., etc. It's unfortunate that it has become that kind of system. But that's the candid answer, because we're not happy with the way that it still was ad hoc. We just don't know what the parameters were. We don't know who scored what the points were. I mean, the entirety of that entire judgment was so that transparency would be there, so that people on the outside can actually look in and say, okay, this person has done this, this, this. At the end of the day, everybody in the profession knows who are the guys who are arguing in court every day, who are appearing there every day, right? And we know who are the people who possibly deserve that and possibly others who don't, right? So it's really become, at least this experience showed me that it was ad hoc. So my designation, as well as many others, all ad hoc.
Yeah. You began your practice directly at the Supreme Court, all right? So you never had that trial experience that a lot of district court lawyers might have.
I did.
Yeah. So did it ever become a hurdle for you when you were arguing cases?
Yeah, it did. But once. Then again, I'm not sure if I could have controlled that, because it was a case where I should have perceived when I was arguing it in the Supreme Court that there was one aspect of a notice of motion, which is an expression used uniquely in Bombay, chamber summons and notice of motion. So there was a question that a notice of motion had to go to a particular type of bench, which, I mean, if you had been practicing there, you would have had an idea. I should have at least known better to at least ask the solicitor that question. I didn't. So when the judge put that question to me, I didn't have an option but to turn to the solicitor and say, well, what's the deal here? But otherwise, you know, a lot of trial questions which arise are actually questions that inhabit your mind only much later. And in the trial process, the skill sets that you use there are not really skill sets that you use when you're distilling down questions of law in the court. And even the judges won't ask you those, you know, tiny little technical questions because they're not concerned about it. They want to entertain the SLP. They don't want to entertain the SLP. That's it. So I haven't found a great disadvantage there. What I can tell you is a seasoned trial lawyer who spent his whole life doing trial law will find himself pretty much at sea if he's going to argue a final year in the Supreme Court. At the same time, someone like me, I would find myself completely at sea if I had to run through a cross-examination in the trial court. I could think that I can be clever and ask the right questions, but the truth is, I'll be at sea.
Yeah. All right.
So it's different skill sets. I keep emphasizing that. It's completely different skill sets. It's not a hierarchy.
Yeah.
It's not that you go to trial court, then you climb up to the high court, then you climb up. It's not that at all. It's completely vertical, different skill sets. If you make the mistake of thinking you will send a Supreme Court senior advocate to overwhelm a Sessions Court judge in a criminal trial to try and get bail, you're barking up the wrong tree. That's not going to happen.
All right. That's a very honest answer, I would say.
Yeah.
And, you know, last question of this segment that I would like to say is that, you know, you said a very beautiful thing in your super lawyer interview. In the last, you said that this might, and you're talking about the youth, basically the college students, right? And you say, this might be the time to walk over and talk to that girl or guy who sits quietly in the second last row without interacting with anybody. Go over, have a coffee together and figure out what makes them tick. Not as a social experiment, but just because it is what humans ought to do. And that really struck me, because my question here is that, you know, with social media, especially with our generation, you know, there's a certain form of polarization. Because today, if I want to make my point, I have a 140 character limit, right? And like I was recently arguing with a close friend of mine with regard to this. You know, he said something like, he was talking about Modi. So he said, you know, he has never had a press conference. I said, no, he had a press conference. It was a very bad press conference. And, you know, obviously, and only Amit Shah spoke. But the thing is, he said, you know, it wasn't in a conventional sense, so I deleted the fact. So I said, listen, you can't delete the fact. You can say that there was one, but it was very bad. Because the thing is, when you say something as an opinion, because it's written, printed, other people can take it as a fact. And that is what polarization has done. And that is what my whole argument is. That do you think we have we have lost the capacity to basically just sit and talk to each other?
Yeah. In fact, one of the reasons for that casual conversation series is that, because I'm still trying to figure out why we have lost that sense of nuance.
Yes.
And while I don't, you remember my, one of the questions that I put to Srinivasan Jain was that, and he had very little good to say about social media and how it reacts. So I think it's given everybody a voice, which is a good thing. But the point is that on every issue, And the media has played a big role in it. Every time they have any issue that they want to discuss, they'll get one BJP guy, one Congress guy. And those guys have been told, just disagree. It doesn't matter what it is, just disagree. So their job is to disagree. And I keep wondering, why have we lost nuance? Yes. As a lawyer in court, it's something that keeps coming back to me again and again and again. That, and it's happened to me very often. You know, in the Sabrimala case, I was appearing for some devotees of Sabrimala. And they were saying, look, the courts shouldn't interfere in this question. Okay? Now, the way people look at it, you're either for women entering the temple or you're not for women entering the temple. Cut and dry. So I had dear friends who were messaging me and saying, you asshole, what are you doing? So I said, hang on, just try and understand what this issue is. Yes. It's very easy for somebody on the outside to say, it's a women's rights issue and you're on the wrong side. So I said, please understand as a lawyer, it's all very well for you to, you know, beat the drum about this. But as a lawyer, I have to understand what that case is and see if it comports and whether it works. And I fully and completely, my conscience is clear that it is not the job of the courts to step in and decide what a best practice for a place of worship should be. Okay, as long as it's not harming the environment, harming individuals, etc., it's a question of faith. If you think it's ridiculous faith, then please, you go and set up your own temple, do your own thing. That's the way religion is supposed to work. It's not supposed to work in such a way that the state will keep interfering to ensure that all religions eventually are the same. And the dangers of this are huge. So for me, the fact that we are taking extreme decisions based on, to a large extent, on personalities, right? Like any political discussion in this country is about, do you hate Modi, do you love Modi? There's more to it than that. There are nuances, and it's difficult, obviously, at a time like this to support a leader who has not shown leadership qualities and not told us what the plan is and how he's going about PM cares and everything else. Because when you cut down lines of communication, right, that's a real problem. Because you're the leader, right? You're supposed to be communicating to us and telling us what the hell is happening. It's great to have you on TV and tell us something substantial. So, but at the same time, it can't be that because Modi is doing it, I'm going to hate it.
Yeah.
But that's what it's become. I mean, and it's not just now. We've had it for the last 10, 15 years. You're a Congi, you're a Bhakt, you get labeled, you're a commie. Those are the labels, one way or the other. So trying to steer clear of those labels is always difficult. So in Sabrimala, I remember the guys, I was arguing against the state on CAA and Kashmir and stuff. And suddenly in Sabrimala, I'm sitting on that side. And a lawyer, a senior law officer of the court tells me, Gopal, what are you doing sitting here? I said, well, I'm with the review petitioners. So he said, why don't you sit that side? You're always on the other side. You know, so you get labeled. This kind of labeling happens all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with you. And also sometimes, you know, people will say that, okay, what you're doing is not wrong, but it is necessarily not the most responsible thing to do. And as people, and if we are more learned than others, we should acknowledge that responsibility. Yeah. And, you know, because I think until and unless we realize that we are part of the problem itself, because our witty one-liners, which don't contribute to the conversation, they are as bad as some Bhakt saying another witty one-liner, right? Because a convenient liberal is as bad as a Bhakt. That is what I believe. Yeah. Because both of you are getting...
No, absolutely.
All right.
I just feel that, you know, we should try and stop using those phrases to describe anybody. You know, you may be a complete right-wing radical. Just don't call him a Bhakt. Because there's a lot about that person we don't know. Right? He may, for example, when there was a Congress government and his dad was critical and the ambulance is taking him to the hospital. They don't allow the ambulance in because there's a Congress VIP who's in the hospital getting treated. That guy becomes a complete right-wing bigot saying, okay, fine, I'm going to see you guys burn, right? But we don't know that backstory. We just know what we see on the outside. So for each human being, there are lots of backstories, right? Yeah. And I'm no big fan of many of these guys who are the ones who are in leadership today. I'm no fan of them. But I believe that each guy has a backstory. Like the person I think we all love to vilify to a large extent is Amit Shah. And just the other day, I noticed that on Amit Shah's website, his official website, he has all the cartoons which make fun of Amit Shah. And I was thinking, this guy is like this this crazy general, right, who stomps over all opposition, for him to put something like that shows one aspect of his personality that we probably missed, right? That he's willing to accept criticism or even laugh at it and put it up on his own website. And these are not like polite, decent cartoons. Some of them are like really hardcore poking fun at him. But he's happy for something which reminds me of what Nehru said to, I think, Lakshman back in the day. Don't spare me.
Yeah.
It shows one aspect of personality. I mean, it's not a clean shit thing, but I'm saying there are so many aspects to each human being.
Yeah.
I think we should stop labeling and judging them so harshly. That's one big difference from the time I was 20. I wasn't like this. I used to be a very harsh judge of people. I used to have very strong codes on this is right, that is wrong. I think age and wisdom tells you that that's probably not the best way to look at things.
All right. Now, coming on to the second segment where we talk about more of your practice. And so do you ever have to compromise on your morals, or do you ever have you ever done that? Because, for example, if you look at your boss, you know, someone that you really look up to, and obviously being the Attorney General, he has to accept questionable briefs such as, you know, Kashmir, like the constitutional amendments, that the recent ones, and he has to do it because that's his job. But will you be able?
No. Let me stop you there. That's a point on which I have a very strong disagreement. He doesn't have to. He is the Attorney General for India. He is not the Solicitor General of India or the Additional Solicitor Generals, who are pretty much on retainer for their clients. The Attorney General for India does not have the government of India as his client. He happens to be the number one law officer in the country. It's a constitutional post. It's like the Election Commission, right? So he's not bound to take a brief from the government of India. He can, in fact, take a stand diametrically opposite to the government of India if he wishes. The fact is that the individuals who have populated that post for many years now have changed the notion of that post from what it was under Syed Talwar. The Attorney General for India is a very unique post. He can by right appear in any court in the country in any cause or action, right? It could be a divorce case. If the Attorney General for India feels that there is something to be said there, he can appear there. He's the only person who, as of right, can appear in parliament on the floor of the house to participate in a debate. The Attorney General for India is not a lawyer for the government. And that, unfortunately, has been the notion that has taken root over several years, and people believe that's what the Attorney General has to do. No, the Attorney General can very clearly take an independent stance from the government. And there's nothing that stops him from doing that. That's exactly what the Attorney General is there for. It happens that the Attorney General is appointed at the pleasure of the government. That means his tenure can be curtailed by the government, right?
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that he's beholden to the government on positions of law.
All right. So how do you like balance that, you know, that morality aspect of your job? For example, if you today become a Solicitor General or an ASG, and you know, and if you have to argue all these questionable constitutional amendments, what will you do?
A couple of times when governments have reached out to me to accept some sort of post, and I've said no for two reasons. One, I would never have entered litigation if I wanted a boss. The second is that I think we have too few lawyers nowadays who are intended to try and protect or represent the citizenry at large, right? And many of them are very happy to beat one political slogan or the other. So they become one spokesperson here, they become a Rajya Sabha guy there, they become a standing counsel somewhere else. So you don't really have anybody standing outside of government raising a question, right? I want to be that. I want to always be outside of government. So I don't want to be in that position where I have to suddenly, because somebody gives me an instruction saying, this is the instruction on the brief, this is what you have to argue, be forced to argue it. Because as a lawyer, as a professional, I will be forced to argue something, which is, I've seen this happen all the time. Guys heavily arguing against pension, which is going to be granted to a guy who's 83 years old and who's been waiting in the courts for 25 years. As a law officer, I would say, don't bloody file that SLP, shut up and just pay him. Right?
Yeah.
But most of our guys are very happy to say, no, file an appeal, it'll lead to floodgates. Their favorite argument, floodgates. So just say that, oh, there'll be 80,000 guys who'll come, therefore we can't do it. It's a heavy bat on the exchequer. to put up a statue of 1,000 crores, there's no problem with the exchequer. But when it comes to paying guys who have served you for 50 years, suddenly there's a problem with the exchequer. So I don't want to be on that side. I mean, so therefore, I don't think those ethical questions are likely to trouble me. But yes, you do have questions that come to you very often, where you feel, hey, am I doing the right thing? Is this the kind of position to take? Because even when the Sabarimala brief that came for the first time, I was a little unsure. Then I saw the nuance and I saw, hey, that's a good point. Privacy and Aadhaar, again, there were questions in my mind that, look, where are we going with this? It started only as an Aadhaar question. It started with that, and then we saw potential in that position that identification is the right for a citizen. You don't look at it as something which is impelling or imperiling you, as long as there are enough safeguards. So you have to look at those. So for me, there have been questions, but I've always, you know, whenever in doubt, grave doubt, I believe that the best thing to do is turn for counsel to somebody whose ethics you trust without doubt. For me, that's my wife. So I turn to her and say, look, this is the problem. What do you think I should do? And she usually errs on the side of caution. So she will ensure that, you know, her advice to me is good. So
all right.
That's pretty much how I resolve it. And I think that's the best way to resolve it.
And, you know, one interesting fact. So I was interning with Advocate Nipun Saxena. So he, so from our chamber itself, we filed a review petition for two of the Aadhaar judgment. And, you know, and there are certain crazy misses by the court. That I remember working on the petition in my in 2018, and I was just in my third sem. And if I could spot them, I didn't understand why did they leave it. And all right, that's a discussion for some other. Now, you know, coming on to slightly, and you know, you can give whatever answer to you want to do this, but the low pay that the juniors get in the Supreme Court or with the seniors, you know, because you said that, you know, your boss was a generous paymaster. But that's certainly not the case with everyone. And you see, there's a barrier created because, you know, it's not about being greedy. It's about, it's a very nuanced point that if you create a barrier for young professionals who are competent to enter this field, they will go and get sucked into these law firm cultures, and you will never see good quality people coming in. Frankly, because people might have responsibilities, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
What are you doing to change that? Like, do you pay your juniors well?
I don't know. You'll have to ask my juniors that. I pay them what I think I can afford, actually, to be honest. I'm not in the position where I can pay as much as I would like to. I would love to pay all of them much more than is possible. Yeah. But it isn't possible. I've got a family to run. I have an office to run. I have 3 kids. There are lots of people who depend on me, right?
Yes.
Employees and drivers and stuff. So, and we have absolutely no support. Both my wife and I, we are from Bangalore and Chennai. We have no family. We have absolutely nothing here.
Yeah.
So for us, with all that we have, I think we are doing our best. We ensure that we give intern stipends. We ensure that we pay the juniors. If there is a good brief on which the junior can get an extra check, that's great. We make sure that juniors can always take their own independent work.
Because Vishal told
me very important
that you encourage people to take independent work, and that is something that I really liked about your chamber. You know that you can take your
own. That has to be. I was speaking to a friend who is a senior counsel in Bangalore, and he was saying very proudly that he doesn't encourage that. So I said, why the hell not? He said, they're working for me. I said, technically, they're not working for you. They're not employees. They're lawyers, professionals who are on retainership with you. And they're not going to grow unless you give them that freedom to grow. So I think there are critical ways you can help them, right? So I will, the best thing is to give them mentorship and support and try and encourage them and ensure the most important thing in the court is visibility. So if we have a visible practice, then they automatically have that visibility. Now, that's not something you can substitute with money. Somebody can pay you a hell of a lot, but you can be in court once a week. You can forget about getting a proper start in the profession because that's not really going to make a difference at all to you in the profession. But if you're in court every single day, and people associate you with a practice which is competent and ethical, I think that makes a big difference for you in the future. They identify you as people from that stable and they believe that can't be all bad. I mean, those guys are competent, so these guys must be good. Like, why would we choose somebody who's thoroughly incompetent and a fool to work with us, right?
Yeah.
Apart from Vishal, of course. I know he's a friend, so you can tell him that.
No, he's actually my senior. You know, I don't know. I know he's a junior, so it's weird for you to listen, but he's kind of like my mentor, you know, like whenever I see. Yeah, because the thing is, I have really, quite often I fall into this law firm, you know, this thing because, and he knows me, you know, so he'll pull me back, he'll like, be patient. Because for, like, I was applying for vacation schemes. So he said, Jalaj, how many times I have told you, be patient. Be patient and things will come to you. And you know,
no, very sound advice. Very sound advice from Vishal. I think patience is key.
Yeah.
Patience is key.
All right. So now, you know, just a couple of questions. Just like, we are nearly the end. I'm so sorry for taking your time.
No problem.
Yeah. So basically, there's lack of judicial discipline and there's enough evidence. Like, I don't want you to articulate that. But my question here is that, do you think the administrative functions of the CJI should be taken away? So that all these listing...
Absolutely. Written about that as well. I think, see, when you're dealing with a large administrative structure, you need to consider that this large administrative structure is doing a very important task, critical task. And B, it's being handled by people who don't have that skill set. However much we may like Chief Justices, their core skill sets of the Chief Justices and of the registrars in charge are not man management, not about ensuring filings efficiency. It's not ensuring getting rid of cases which are pending. Their core skill set is adjudication. They should stick to that. The people who have these core skill sets are people who have been trained in management, in data crunching, in solution building. Those are guys with MBAs and stuff like that who do that for large corporations. They do it with great ease, right? So what we need really is a CEO for the Supreme Court. Somebody who's not beholden to the court, who's not some lawyer who will say, Ji sir, jaise aap bataye saab. It should be some guy who actually says, my lord so-and-so, you had 50 cases on Monday. You were able to finish only 20. So from Friday onwards, I'm going to give you only 20. While somebody else, you've done 100 in a day. So I'm going to try and give you that many to ensure there's efficiency. Somebody else, sir, you rose at 1 o'clock when you should have sat till 4 o'clock. Was there a problem? You need somebody who's going to do that on the administrative side, right? Who's going to treat them as equals. And that's the only way we're going to have a solution to this.
Plus the thing I feel is that, you know, a lot of times because of the administrative blunders, the thing is the integrity of a judge is in question. And one thing that really has to happen is the integrity of the, like, the Supreme Court judge has to be ironclad. Because whenever, you know, half the problems with the CJI is that, you know, he's not giving this case to him. He's not on the bench, things like that. I mean, if you can get rid of that, the general image of the Supreme Court can be, you know, I think it can use a boost right now because we really feel sometimes, you know, what is happening. All right.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Okay, so, you know, this is a very interesting question because you formed a committee at NLS to revise the constitution for elections of students. And then you helped also Bhutan, the Kingdom of Bhutan, redraft their constitution. And
since law student, there's an interesting backstory to that committee being formed in National Law School.
Okay.
When we were in our third year, we had... our dean was N.L. Mitra, Professor Mitra. And Professor Mitra came up with this idea that we will import the DIPOS-TRIPOS system from the UK in law school, which meant that the courses that we were supposed to take in our fourth and fifth year, the specialist courses would now be available only to those above a CGPA of 6 and above a CGPA of 5, leaving everybody else without the option of taking those courses at all. So we objected. We called a general body meeting of the student body. And by a vote of, I think, 280-2, the two guys who voted CGPAs above 5 and 6, we voted against this and we gave the resolution to the director. They were going to go ahead with it anyway. The college closed on vacation. Once the college closed on vacation, I got in touch with the president of our student body, Shreyas Jaisimha, who's a practicing advocate in Bangalore. And I said, what are we doing about it? He said, I don't know, the college is on vacation, so there's nothing we can do. It's going to happen. So then I wrote a letter to each of the members of the governing council of the law school. Guys, bar council, judges of Supreme Court, etc., etc. And there were a few of us who had decided on doing this. And we signed off saying, on behalf of the students of the law school. When one of these bar council guys got in touch with Mitra, who was director, and said, what is this happening? How are you imposing this? It will have retrospective effect, etc., etc. Mitra was angry. So he got in touch with Shreyas. Shreyas promptly threw me under the bus. Instead of saying that, yes, it was sent on behalf of the student body, he said, yeah, Gopal sent it. So, and I didn't hold an office in the student body. So Mitra called me in his room. He said, what is this? How can you do something like this? I said, sir, I'm sorry, but it's wrong. You can't suddenly impose this retrospectively on us in our third year. If we knew that you're going to do stuff like this, from first year, we would have ensured we had CGP above 6. Knowing full well, none of us would have got CGP above 6. Mitra, to his credit, was an extremely liberal guy. And I think he saw a bit of the rebel in me, in him or whatever. And he said, I'll tell you what. You have had problems with, at that point of time, a student body. The voters in the student body were only those who were on any of the committees, the cultural committee, literary committee, sports committee. So out of our full strength of the student body of about 500 or 400 people, we had only about 60 people voting. So now nobody else had a say. So I told him the reason is because you're doing something like this and the only people who are entitled to vote and elect our representatives are those guys. So then he said, okay, very well. Let's have a review of the constitution. I said, excellent. He said, you head the committee. I said, no. Everybody knows that I've been at the head of this thing. They will think I did this deliberately so that I can have a say on that committee. That's not true. I'm very happy to suggest other names who will be. So Nandan Kamath of NK Law and the Go Sports Foundation was one of them. PM Timaya was another. Finding it difficult to recollect the names of the other people on the committee. And we sat and we had the constitution reviewed and the college allowed that to be passed through.
Can you tell me, as a young law student in this environment, how do I express my dissent without the fear of authority?
It depends, I think, about who you are expressing dissent against. What platform you're using and the language you're employing. Very often, if you are using a platform like anything on social media, you can be sure there's going to be a blowback. Anything you say will have disagreements, right? Even this interview you put up, there's going to be disagreements. People are going to make comments, whatever. It's going to happen. So the idea is for you to express what you think is right. And then if there are consequences to be faced, face the consequences. Sometimes though, and it can't be overstated, sometimes very often in fact, it might be good to keep quiet if there is no injustice being caused by that which you're dissenting against. You may have a different point of view. You may have a different opinion. Nobody may be in harm's way. Somebody may not be particularly vulnerable so that they cannot resist it on their own.
Yeah.
In those kind of situations, it's not necessary. For example, if they make a caricature of Rahul Gandhi tomorrow and you dissent against that view, you disagree with it, may not be really essential to pick up a cudgel for a guy who has enough people to defend him, right? But maybe somebody who's vulnerable, unfortunate, who has nobody coming to their aid, and the continuing oppression may really push them to the brink. That's possibly when you need to speak up, and your voice may make all the difference.
All right. Thank you. That's a very good answer. Now, you know, coming on to the last question of this segment, you're very passionate about environment law, and I've seen that, and you argue quite a few cases, and then you're passionate about constitutional law, but I mean, you have a standing, you know, you have in the Supreme Court now, to say, but what is your biggest challenge? What is the thing that excites you?
Two different things. If it's about the challenges that I think, particularly with reference to environmental law, it's getting judges to realize that there are some things that cannot be compensated. It's very deeply rooted in the judicial mindset that one tree chopped down can be replaced by 10 others. Okay? It's very deeply rooted. It's very deeply rooted that if you're going to divert land which is meant for, say, a reservoir or a lake or a pond, that if the project proponent dumps 5 crores, that's going to be okay. That's not okay. These are irreversible things. So for me, understanding that environmental compensation has a very, very limited role to play in the days to come is a huge challenge. We need more people to talk about that and understand that there is absolutely no question of compensating for destruction to the environment, right? And getting a judicial mindset to wrap itself around that, that's a huge challenge. The second thing is for judges to treat the courts as their own institutions to which they belong, even once they demit office, that's a huge challenge. Individual judges and their conducts seem to be giving labels to the institution.
Exactly.
And that's happened for a while. We have a number of excellent top-class judges, right? They're not in the limelight. They're not people who push themselves into it. They're not given the opportunity to handle cases which are extremely sensitive for whatever best reasons known to others. And they obviously must be chafing at the fact that I do the right thing every day, right? But because of these other guys, my institution gets a bad name and then my friends call me up and say, what are you guys doing? When I'm doing the right thing, right? It's important for us to understand that there is a certain level at which you can criticize individual judicial conduct without it being contempt and without fearing contempt. So that's another major challenge that I see in the coming days. I think the third major challenge, and this is a huge one, is that because of this kind of conduct by colleagues which goes unchecked, and with more judges thinking, hey, let's be polite and decent, let's not call out the guy who's giving us all a bad name, yeah, right? Because they're sticking with a traditional mode of opining. We have more and more lawyers, excellent young legal minds, demurring when it comes to accepting judgeship. Because it seems to be an endless area of punishment, right? You get paid very little, you get overworked, then you get blamed, you get criticized. Nobody wants to be your friend. So why would you accept judgeship? Only because of a sense of duty, right?
Yeah.
But we shouldn't make it that hard for them to discharge a duty that they would like to discharge.
All right. Yeah. Also, now, just at the end, a quick rapid fire, you know, 30 seconds.
Okay.
All right. We know that Rahul Dravid was your tenant at one point of time, and you're a very big cricket fan. How was the experience? Like, how is it to, you know, just like being a cricket fan and having Rahul Dravid living in your house, and we can call him up and say, Abhi, like, you have to pay me rent or whatever. Like, how's the...
No. It wasn't like that. Rahul, as you know, was born before I was.
Okay.
And Rahul's parents, the Dravids, were tenants in our family home in Bangalore, in Indranagar.
Okay.
There were tenants there at the time that Rahul was born. I think Rahul was born in Pune also. So they were tenants at that point of time.
Right.
And then they went away. We came to that house and they stayed like a few streets down on 12th Main in Indranagar in Bangalore.
Yeah.
So Rahul's brother Vijay and I know each other well. We played cricket together and stuff. So he was never, you know, he I remember still the day on which he made his, when his name was included in the test 11 for the first time. I was going for maths tuition classes in my 10th standard.
Yes.
And Vijay was also coming for the same maths tuition.
Yeah.
And our teacher came out, Castellino, our maths tuition teacher. And he said, Vijay, congrats. Rahul is going to make his debut. And we were obviously all over the moon because he'd been doing ferociously well for such a long time. And we had wondered why it took so long. Because, you know, Sachin had been given his cap earlier. Saurav had been given his... Rahul, I don't know why they were waiting so long because he's such a good boy. But no, we never had that landlord-tenant relationship at all. We, yeah. Our paths have crossed many, many times. So, but he's a great guy. He's, for me, the best batsman India has ever produced.
Yeah, the ball. Yeah. Obviously. And you know, when Vishal told me that he was your tenant, I thought, sir is so rich that Rahul Dravid is his tenant.
Are you crazy? Not at all.
Yeah.
We're all normal middle class families in Bangalore.
All right. Now, what is your cheap thrill? Like, my cheap thrill is I have 800 followers on Instagram. So when I put a question or a survey, around 200 to 300 respond to it. You know, yes, no. So if I'll say, you know, for example, if I say, how many people broke up during lockdown? People actually reply.
Really?
Yeah. What is your cheap thrill as a senior counsel or, you know, as a people who employs 4 or 5 people? What is your cheap thrill?
I don't know. It's never been about people, actually. My cheap thrill is usually in large gatherings to escape from them. And usually, I'll tell you one thing that actually happened. And I was thinking to myself later and thinking, am I nuts? It happened that one of my lawyer colleagues, who's a friend, his dad used to be a Supreme Court judge till recently. Yeah. But he's on one of the tribunals in Delhi. Now, the judge's grandkids, that's my friend's kids, and our kids go to the same school. So they had a birthday party for the kid on the lawns, those massive Lotian's lawns of these guys in central Delhi. So I took my kids and went there. Now, I love hanging around with these kids. I mean, I've known them for like 4 or 5 years now. They're all 9 or 8 or 9 or something. So, and there are many of them, about 15, 16 kids.
Yeah.
So I devised this game where they have to catch me, right? So I had running across a Supreme Court judge's lawn, me streaking between trees and bushes and stuff like that, while all the other adults are standing around there, gently sipping coffee and tea and eating a sandwich and trying to be all polite and genteel. And there was me going nuts. This is like last year, running around the lawn with 14 kids running behind me trying to catch me. For me, the cheap thrill is to do something irreverent in the most reverential of places.
Right.
So that's a cheap thrill for me.
Yeah. All right. The funniest thing that has ever happened to you in the Supreme Court? Something, you know, I think there are quite a few because I can see that smile.
Many of which I can't mention.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, there's my dear friend Siddharth Dave, senior advocate of the Supreme Court, designated at the same time. So we are in the coffee shop, which is this little place that we take refuge during the day when gaps wouldn't matter.
Yeah.
So it was Siddharth's birthday, I discovered. And they have these completely cheap, filthy cakes that which nobody buys, right? In the coffee shop. So I ordered a cupcake and I told everybody around that it's Dave Saab ka birthday hai. So we all started singing happy birthday loudly. And he's like a prim and proper Dun school boy, right? And you could see him blushing and turning pink. He was like, I'll kill you. I swear I'll kill you. When I get a chance, I'm going to kill you. And our birthdays are like about 10 days apart.
Okay.
So he waited for my birthday. My birthday was a Sunday. I had calculated this.
Yeah.
So on Monday when I came in, he brought the cake and decided to cut it. Before the cake could come, I stood up and said, Bhai Saab, Saab, mera birthday hai, happy birthday boli. Completely pulling the rug from under his feet because he thought he would embarrass me out of this.
Yeah.
So I wound up embarrassing him. So I love the convivial nature that we have as friends at the bar rather than anything else. There are funny instances, but I some of them, you know, I've heard of, not experienced personally, etc. Some of them are a little embarrassing to others, so I wouldn't want to share them.
Obviously. What has been the silliest thing that you have been asked to do, you know, as an advocate? That, or to be, as the, I don't know, a client that came to you and be like, can you please help me or something like that?
Well, many people think they can just call and just start off. So that happens a lot. Yesterday, somebody called me up and said, matrimonial case hai, mera divorce karna hai aapko. So I said, look, we have certain practices here. I don't speak to clients directly. You'll have to get in touch with some advocate and record.
Yeah.
So he couldn't understand or grasp that at all. And I don't blame them. Most people don't even understand what this AOR practice is. All they understand is you're a lawyer, right?
Yeah.
We got your number. Why can't you help us?
Yeah.
So that's happened a lot. The most disturbing thing that happens, which really has nothing to do with law, is the fact that my number, for some reason, maybe about 20 years ago, used to belong to the Simtex Coil Company. It's a company that makes coils for air conditioners. So every 3 days, I get a call from somebody who says, sir, aapke paas coil pada hai. To be honest, 50% of the time, I say, ye wrong number hai. But it's the other 50% that's fun. So I ask him what type of coil he wants. So I've learned a lot about coils. AC coil. So if Simtex Coil Company is ever watching this, please learn that you tell your customers to correct yourself. Many times I've said, "Chotu yahan pe nahi hai, aapko pick up karna padega." I've given them addresses in Ghazipur and stuff.
All right, that was genuinely. I mean, to see someone of your stature doing that, it's quite hilarious. All right, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast. So now, Mr. Gopal, can I have a job at your chambers?
Well, let's see. First, I go through a strict vetting process.
Yes, yes.
I have internships.
Yeah.
Then I take advice from college seniors of yours. and then we discuss about life ahead.
Well, then I think it will be tough because that advice won't be very nice. All right.
okay.
All right, guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot for doing that. And you know, and thanks for being so candid. And honestly, and you're the only person I could have done this. Genuinely. You know, you're like one of a kind. Genuinely. And
thank you. Thank you very much, Jalaj. It's been a refreshingly different experience from ones that I'm accustomed to. And I'm glad that you've done this. And I hope you'll get many more of my colleagues and embarrass them similarly in days to come.
All right. No, but for this season, only one senior counsel. Because I want to explore everything.
Okay.
I'm not that. Thank you.
Yeah. So all the best. Thank you.
All right.